So welcome to the first session of this afternoon. So this is a session on provable security. We'll have three talks in this session, and the first talk is on attacks and security proofs on EAX Prime. And so the paper is by Kazuhiko Minamatsu, Stefan Lux, Henriku Morita, and Tetsuo Iwata, and Kazuhiko will give the talk.
Thanks for the introduction. And this is a joint work by Stefan Lux and Henriku Morita and Tetsuo Iwata. So, the topic is authenticated encryption. And it is a symmetric key function that combines the authentication and encryption. And it prevents the adversary to eavesdrop the plain text and forgery attack. Actually, as we were discussed with the invited talk done by Dan Bernstein, it has been widely used in practice. We have many protocols operated in the internet and many examples of storage and mobile satellite communication using AE. So, in this talk, I'd like to study the security of EX Prime, which is AE based on the standard block cipher, AES. It is defined as ANSI C12.22, which is to design a communication protocol for the smart grid and smart meter. And the specification also, the same specification also appeared at several standards. And finally, it was proposed to NIST in consideration to the inclusion of the special fabrication in 2011. And we already see some real products implementing ANSI C12, some smart meters and their management systems. And as its name suggests, the EX Prime is derived from the EAX mode of operation, which was developed by Bellale, Rogaway, and Wagner at FSE 2004. And the original EX has a proof of security based on the standard assumption of the internal block cipher. For EX Prime, it is a modified version of EAX, and the designer of EX Prime claims that there are some optimizations to reduce the number of block cipher calls and memory consumptions. However, there is no published formal security analysis today. So in this talk, I'd like to describe that the security of EX Prime is sharply separated with respect to the length of an input variable called clear text. The first result is that when the clear text is only one block, that means that it is at most 128 bits in the standard setting, and then we can mount effective attacks to perform the forgery and plaintext distinguisher and even the plaintext recovery in under some special scenario. The positive side, we also show that when clear text is more than one block, more than 128 bits, it recovers the proof of security based on the standard assumption of the internal block cipher. So the original EX encryption is here. As you can see, there are three input variables. N means the nonce, and M means the plain text, and H means the header. And the global structure is the encryption and the authentication, where the encryption is performed by the counter mode encryption, and the authentication is done by the CMAC. And as you can see, there are three CMAC variants, CMAC 0, and CMAC 1, and CMAC 3. So to generate these variants, the CMAC is actually tweaked. And in the case of EX Prime, the things here, as you can see, there are only two input variables. And now N is renamed to the clear text, which combines the nonce and header. So it must be unique and it conveys some header information. There are also some differences. For example, the counter mode is renamed to the CTR prime mode encryption, which in this mode, some bits of the initial counter values are set to zero to suppress the carry bit propagation of the implementation. And also the most important thing is that there are only two variants of schema, tweaked schema, and the different method of tweaking, different tweaking method of schema is applied. And the different tweaking method of schema yields two versions, schema D and schema Q. And they are slightly more efficient than the original version of tweaked schema in original EAX. However, this makes our attacks possible. So let me describe briefly the original schema, which is a NIST standard. It is a CVC map with additional Rust masking using 2L or 4L bars, where the L means the encryption of the old L N bit, and the 2L means the doubling of L in GF22 over N, and 4L means the twice doubling. And they are used here, and depending on the length of the Rust block. And in case of EAX, the tweaking method is quite simple. We need three variants, so that we prepare three tweak bars in n bits, means 0, 1, 2, and the tweak is prepended to the message and performs the CMAP. So the scheme is here, and you can see that this value can be pre-computed and used as the initial masking value. For EX prime, the tweaking method is defined, and we only need two variants, and the tweak is called the D and the Q, and the D means the 2L and the Q means the 4L, and you use these values depending on the tweak as the initial masking. As you can see, the D means the 2L, the Q and the 4L, so the set of the initial masking values and the set of the final masking values are the same. This makes it easy to mount some attacks and to allow us to distinguish the two functions from the independent pseudonym functions. So if the input is only one block, for example, the CMAPD accepting the input block of n bit, then the initial masking and the final masking value are the same, so that the cancel, the output is the EK of M1 and sub 1. In case of CMAP Q, and the input is shorter than n bit, then it applies some padding, and initial masking and the final masking values are again the same. So the cancel, the output is Q. So rating M1 and M2 to satisfy this condition, these outputs are the same, so which were quite unlikely if these two functions were independent PRS. So based on this fact, we can mount various attacks. The first is a forgery attack, which is quite simple. We first prepare the N and the C and the T satisfying this relationship, just the same as the previous example, and set the fake tag to be the other value. And I forgot to mention that there are final tag truncation to 32 bits, so the tag is 32 bits. All their bar. This attack, if we mount this attack, these barrels are the same, so cancel the tag are always all zero. So they're always accepted as bar. And this attack, of course, requires no encryption query, so it is quite practical. And as a result, the decryption oracle are forced to see the random break text, with less, even if it was random, so may not fit in the real protocol or not, so it is valid. So this may give a great speculation for future attack, possible attack. And we can question some barriers of attack having different ranges in 4N and C. So considering the distinguished attack, the situations are almost the same. We first perform one encryption query having n-bit clear text and the empty string, empty plain text. Then the set the, see if the response here is all the tag value or not. This attack again almost always successful unless the random oracle accidentally returns the same original tag value. And we can extend this attack slightly even if the message is not empty but has quite short ranges. And finally, the attack can be extended to the plain text recovery in some restricted scenario, which is that the array set above shares the secret key, and if it drops the encrypted communication and get the N star, C star, T star. And we assume that it can ask the other N triplet of N, C, T to the bottom, seeing it as a decryption oracle. So here we turn the decrypted message over bot message. And the goal of the IB is to find a part of partial information of N star. So, if the N star is N bit and C star is shorter than N bits, then we first do the forgery attack described before with these values and setting the original tag value. So, as I described, the forgery attack is always successful. The decryption oracle returns the M tilde, which allows us to derive the key string used for this clear text value. And as this clear text value used for the wiretap eavesdropped communication, we can recover the M star by computing this formula, taking the summation. And I would like to mention that this attack can, even if the C star has more than n bits, not shorter than n bits, this attack still recovers the first some bits of M star whose length is a C star, a C used by the attack, which means that roughly the utmost one block printed, the first one block of the M star can be recovered. And this attack always works. So there are our attacks we find. So a natural question might be right, that the if these attacks can be applicable to the real protocol, real devices operating the ANSI C12.22. But unfortunately, we have no clear answer for now. We searched some ANSI document, and but no clear answer. In fact, I asked my company's engineering to have some ANSI devices that using this protocol, but they are not. Unfortunately, my company have no such product. But what that shows that the clear text length check is needed anyway, and whether the ANSI C12 allows the one block clear text or not, and for both encryption and decryption queries assigned. Okay, so there are another natural question. Is ES prime secure if the clear text is always more than n bits? And in the following, I would like to describe this is true. So the problem setting is here, which is quite standard. The advisory can query to the encryption oracle and the decryption oracle. And the important thing is that in both queries, the clear text has at least two blocks, meaning that the n and the tilde is more than n bits. Always more than and any encryption queries allowed provided the clear text is unique, which means the non-suspecting adversary. But decryption query, we have no limitation on the decryption query. So any clear text used in the decryption oracle can be used in the decryption oracle. So the security notion is here. Which is again quite standard. We consider the two standard security notions. The privacy means that the cipher texts are hard to distinguish from random, and authenticity, which means that a successful forgery is hard. And the results are here. We obtained the security bound, and these security bounds are considering the maximum advantage of the adversary when the internal block cipher is a random permutation. And the final tag truncation is parameterized by tau, so the tau is tau bit. And so in EX prime, the tau becomes 32. As you can see, that these bounds are quite standard looking, so burst the bound with respect to the amount of the queries used by the adversary and the block size. So the proof strategy is here. First, we redefine the EX prime as a mode of OMAP extension, which is a pair of functions denoted by the OMAP E of 0 and the OMAP E of 1. And we then prove that the OMAP E is a pair of computationally independent pseudo-random functions, which is most technical. And finally, prove that the security of EX prime with perfect OMAP extension, which means that the pair of random functions. The overall proof follows the original EX proof by Berardi, Olave, and Wagner, with some extensions taken from the OMAP proofs by Iwata and Kurosawa. So the OMAP U0 is here, which uses an n-bit random permutation and additional random masking value, U. And it computes the CMAP D, tweaked version, and the key string computation of the CTRM prime, which is here, key string. And the important thing is that the input is always more than n-bits. And for OMAP U of 1, it computes the CMAP Q. But we again use the same masking value U as in the OMAP U of 0. And it is easy to observe that this function pair, OMAP E, can simulate EX prime for both encryption and decryption. As you can see, this U value is not appeared in the original EX prime computation, but in the tau computation, we already need the sum of this value and this value, so the U is always cancelled, so not for the problem. And I'd like to mention that this use of U is missing in the current preproceding version of the proof, so it contains a bug. We already fixed, so preproceding version and the forthcoming proof version will fix appear the corrected proof. Sorry. And we need to prove that the OMAP extension is indistinguishable from a pair of random functions. So to do this, we introduce some helper random variables, which is always cancelled in the Regit Mason computation, OMAP extension computation. And decompose it as a pair, some set of 10, actually 10, set of 10 functions, Q1 to Q10, which improves helper random variables in its computation. And we then prove that these function sets are indistinguishable from the set of random functions, even if they are independently accessed. This is the proof technique appeared at the OMAP proof. So the finalization is here, which is quite standard and uninteresting. I would like to skip. And finally, I'd like to discuss how to fix the flaw of EX prime. So to do so, we do not want to change the algorithm of EX prime as we may have, as we have already real working modules. So the first method, the simplest one, is to prepend a n-bit constant to clear text, use it as a new clear text. The second method uses two block cipher keys, k and k prime, and ek is used for the clear text of more than one block. And otherwise, we use the ek prime with prepending to n. So these two keys can be basically should be independent, but if we pay some enough attention to avoid the related key attacks, k prime can maybe generated from k also with some constant. And the third method, which is almost the same as the second method, we use a trickable block cipher using additional independent n-bit key now. So EK is used for the clear text of more than one block, and the other case that we use the EK tilde L, E tilde K sub, sub K L, which is here, for with prepending to N. So each method has good and bad points with respect to the efficiency and the security model, so it's hard to determine which is the best in. All situations may depend on the real protocols. So I would like to finish my talk with the lessons learned from this study. So the first, a seemingly small change can result in fatal consequences. I guess this is a repeated problem in real-world cryptography, but again, and the second point is that there are threats out that CMAP is one PRF, so generating multiple PRF from one CMAP function is sometimes dangerous and we need care. In that respect, EX prime employs a simple and secure method. And the third thing is that the importance of security proofs, in that our proof shows that the clear text range check is sufficient for secure implementation of EX prime, which might be cumbersome but secure. So that's end of my talk, so and I would like to end with my son, Fanny. Thank you.
So thanks very much. Any questions or comments? Okay, I have one. Is it possible to define some general properties of the tweaking methods for CMAC?
Yes, it is. It may be possible, but first we define which class of tweaking method is allowed, and then we define in these classes what property is required to the masking values. So it is basically possible, I guess.
There is no question.
Okay.
If not, let's thank the speaker again.